Okay, let's see. Okay, do I have any sound now? Are you hearing me? Do I have sound? Can you hear me? Oh, yes. Okay, good. Okay, good. I'm glad you got sound. I don't know what was going on with that at all, so sorry about that. Okay, the paints. Let's get to the paints. Okay, and I use DecoArt Americana Craft Paint on all my designs. So we're going to use Desert Turquoise, Raw Sienna, Snow White or Titanium White, Lamp Black, Soft Black, Burnt Umber, Tomato Red, Tuscan Red. We're going to need a dark blue for the background. On my packet, which you can purchase on my website, lonnalam.com, I listed midnight blue, but you can, if you don't have that color, you can use deep midnight blue, navy blue, Prussian blue, whatever dark blue that you have, and if it's not quite dark enough, you can add tiny little bit of black to it. I've got some gray sky out. You don't necessarily have to have that because you can mix black and white. But I got it out so that I wouldn't have to mix and I could just quickly paint in my cardinal. And then this one is optional. It's a neon fiery red to brighten up our cardinal. And this one is also optional, extreme sheen silver, which you can add to the topper to give it a really shiny look. And I always have a misting bottle that I spritz my palette with water with, and that's my clean water that I use when I am needing water for floating. So let's get ready to paint. My foam roller has just about dried out, so I am going to get it wet, squeeze out all of the moisture, and then squeeze it out into a paper towel. We just want it to be damp. And then I'm going to grab any dark blue. Let me move this one out of the way. And if you've got a heat tool or a hair dryer, you'll probably need that to dry in between layers. So I'm going to apply this to the background. And we'll just cover the whole surface. We don't have to worry about not painting that topper. We'll come in and paint that gray later, if you're painting on the same kind of surface that I'm painting on. So this is deep midnight blue, I think, is the one that I grabbed. I feel like I have a little bit of moisture still in my roller there. So I'm not really sure everything that I was saying that you missed. So if someone wants to leave in the comments where you started hearing me, I'll try to go back over while this is drying and tell you what you missed. So I'm not going to put this in water yet because I need to apply two coats to it. So I'm going to quickly dry this. And using a foam roller will give a little bit of texture to your surface. But you can use a artist sponge to paint your background, put your base coats on with as well. So just get this dry, and that did a pretty good coat on there. I'm going to take my stippling sponge out and squeeze all the moisture out of it, and I'm going to take all my sponges out. I'm not going to use the sea sponges for my background. I'm going to use this stippling sponge that I have here. So I'm just going to take these out and move them out of the way. And my artist sponge, because I want my roller to soak in this water so that it doesn't dry out. I've probably had this little roller here for 5 years. It's been a good little roller. So I was going to apply a second coat on here, but because we're going to do all this stippling in the background, I don't really need to do that now. So I'm just going to put my roller into my water. and let that set over there and dry. So I've got my stippling sponge now. Kathy says, when you asked if we could hear you, we could not hear before. Yes, you couldn't hear before I started my paint list. So if you need me to go over the things that I'm using again and tell you what they are, I know that you could see, but if you need me to specifically tell you, like the brushes or anything, put that in the comments and I will go over the brushes again and tell you what they are. All right, on my palette, I've got my deep midnight blue, but I'm going to put a little bit more out here. I'm going to want to put my gloves on for this. And our desert turquoise. You don't really need a whole lot of paint. This is not a very big surface. If you're doing a, this is a lamp black here. If you're doing a larger surface, you can use a little bit more paint. So let me get my gloves on. I've just got some disposable gloves here, so as soon as I'm done, I can just toss them in the trash. And if you've got a nice manicure, you want to protect that manicure. So, all right, so I'm going to make sure the moisture's out of that. We want a little bit of moisture in it. We can always grab more moisture in our sponge, but we don't want to have a ton of it in because it will thin our paint down and we won't get a really nice look. So on one edge of this sponge, I'm going to get my base color of blue and a little tiny bit of black. Okay, this is going to be mostly on the outside of the circle here. And I'm just going to keep picking up as I need. And this doesn't take very long on this little bitty surface. I'm going to zoom you in a little bit. I'm just putting like a dark blue border around this. A little bit of blue, a little bit of black. Black can take over, so you kind of got to be careful with the black. Bring that around like that, and in the center we're going to do the turquoise. And so I'm going to start putting this in, tapping it in the center, and then pick up a little bit of my midnight blue or deep midnight blue, whichever one you're using, and then start kind of blending that together. We want to create this fun little bright area in the back of the background, and it's all going to just blend out beautifully. And the more that you put in there, you could also add a little bit of white to your desert turquoise if you want it even brighter. You could use just turquoise blue as well. Doesn't have to be desert turquoise if you don't have that color. I love desert turquoise though. It's got a little bit more white in it than turquoise blue, but they both are beautiful in creating a really fun mottled background back here. And I'm just going to keep adding until I feel like I have a nice mottled background. Till it looks just like a night sky. That's kind of what I'm going for. And then you'll want to dry this. Okay, that looks pretty good there. Pretty looks like a night sky. So again, I'm going to put this sponge in my water basin. Move that out of the way. Get rid of these gloves so we don't need them anymore. And dry my surface. And then we're going to get ready to put our line drawing on. So this is when you will need your line drawing on tracing paper. And you want to make sure that your background is dry before you put your line drawing on, because if it's not, then that graphite will just set immediately into your paint and you won't be able to get that out. You'll have to be sure and paint over it, which we're using a lot of opaque colors, dark values and things. So you should be able to cover it up pretty easily. Alright, mine feels pretty dry. So now I'm going to get my pattern and lay it on here. Try to line up where I had it. I'm going to put a little piece of tape on here to tape it down. And if you have any questions along the way, let me know. I'm going to grab my white graphite. And I'm going to trace the shape of our post here. It doesn't have to be perfect. I want to get an idea of where the wire is going across here. Yeah, it's coming across here, and the wire doesn't have to be, I mean, this could be a really old wire, so it could be hanging down. Alright, let's add our bird, and we just need the shape. We don't need all these little lines or the wing line right now. We do want the legs coming down, and then I'm not going to worry about the feet because I need to see exactly where that wire is. So we should look something like that to get started with it. And then I'm going to draw in, grab my white pencil here. My topper is just a curved line across here. Okay, so when we paint our bird in gray, we can go up here and paint the topper in as well. All right, let me get this out of the way. I'm going to put my bird up on my easel, or my surface up on my easel, so that you can see it better. Okay, so you should be able to see it much better now. Alright, we're going to start some base coats here. So, on my palette, we are going to put some gray sky out for our bird. We're going to go ahead and get the base coats on for these, and then we're going to work on the bouquet background, because we can work around these areas. And the post, I'm going to, let me find my instruction here. It's a mix of raw sienna and white. So let's put some raw sienna out. That one must have a chunk of something in it. Didn't want to come through. Raw sienna, some white, and some gray sky. Now, with craft paints, you do have to shake them up. So shake them up. It's like your house paint. You're painting your walls. All the pigment falls to the bottom. And then some gray sky we will need for our bird and our topper. So I'm going to paint the bird and the topper in first. And it will probably take a couple of coats to paint this in. I'm not going to worry about... Oh, get you down here so you can see what I'm doing. I'm not going to worry about the edges of my piece. If I want the edges painted, I can come back and do that later, but I don't think I will be doing that. And then we're going to paint our bird in with gray sky, the whole entire bird. And the reason I am doing the bird in gray first, because red is kind of a transparent color. Most reds are. There are some that are not as transparent. that have probably some white or some yellow in with them. So they're not as transparent, but overall most reds are transparent. So you need to undercoat with something so you're not putting like 50 coats of red paint on something. And some people like to use a dark green or an orange. I have always used gray, always. I used to paint murals, and it was gray was the color that would give me the true color of that red. Any other color would change that red just a little bit and would not be the color I would be looking for. So I always undercoat with gray sky. Okay. Now we're going to mix these two colors together, raw sienna and white, and just get a nice kind of wood color looking here. And I put those lines through there, but now I just realize I have to paint right through them, so I'm just going to create a kind of rusty brown color here, a lighter than what the raw sienna is that comes out of the bottle. I think I need to go to my bigger brush so I'm not working quite so hard. Wake my brush up. So yeah, bigger brush will get the job done much faster. And everything will take two coats. And while the second coat is drying on this, well actually we'll have to get the second coat dry before we do our background. And I love the bokeh effect background. I just think it's my favorite. But the first one that I painted was the one with the snow. So this is just all base coats, undercoats, you know, we got lots of values that will go on top of this, so a little bit more of the brown in there. Try and get right up to my lines here. Something in my paint. Alright. Okay, I'm going to quickly dry this because I want to put the second coats on. And then we're going to work on that bokeh effect in the background. And the heat tool doesn't take very long. These two were almost pretty dry. So it's this one mostly that I got to get dry. And if you're letting it dry on its own, you can tell it's dry. If it's cool to the touch, it is still wet. So this one just needs a little bit. Just to fill in some gaps, not much. You don't necessarily have to have a second coat on your bird if your first coat went really well. And that first coat was pretty good, but my topper up here definitely needs a second coat on it. And I don't know if anyone's painting along with me or if you're just watching. I am kind of a fast painter, so this video will be up for you to watch whenever you want. I can paint along at your pace. All right, let's put our second coat on our post here. Oh, goodness, goober goobers. My raw sienna was a little thick. I need some water. So I don't know if you noticed, I spritzed this whole side of my palette with clean water. Any of you that have painted with me before know that that is what I do, to have clean water for floating or for any other reason that I need some clean water. Because sometimes if you go to your water basin with your brush, you get way more water in your brush than you need. And then it's like this vicious cycle of trying to get some of the water out, but just enough for the brush, and when you've got little drops over there, they're ready, and you can just grab them and paint. So there's the second coat on our posts. Let me dry that. Grab my stencils over here. Now my stencil, my circles are just a mixture of the raw sienna and the white. I didn't use any other colors than that. And I use them very lightly in the background. So most of them you can see the background through those circles. So you don't have to make them opaque. Seeing some of the background through it is actually a better look, I think. But that is a personal preference. So let me show you if you want to paint one in with a paintbrush. If you want to paint them in with a paintbrush, you're just going to have some different values of these two colors here. Some lighter and darker values. This is all I used on mine. So you'll just paint some circles in, and I don't want that much paint on there, so I'm going to grab a little drop of water so I can thin that down and make it a more transparent circle. And you can paint all of your circles in with a paintbrush. It does take a little bit longer, but very doable. I like to use a stencil because the stencil just gets things done so much faster, and I can move on. It's getting to the part where you are making the pretty stuff. That's the part that you want to get to. All right, so I'm going to take my 3/4 inch stencil, and you can use a medium or a small brush, and I'm just going to start with a little bit of paint. Not too much. I'm going to tap, 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 and remove a little bit, and I'm just going to start putting in some. Now you'll notice I'm tapping in my stencil instead of just rubbing in my stencil. You can rub, you know, do the standard swirling and putting it in. That puts a little bit more paint down at one time. And I want to try and keep this a little bit on the lighter side so I can see the background. And you're just going to go around the whole entire piece and put as many circles on here as you want. And start out with one value mix and then add or take away more of the raw sienna or more white, however you would like it to look. Put one up here. And now I'm going to add a little bit more white to it. Tap, 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 tap. I'm going to put a couple more big ones on here, and then I'm going to go to my smaller stencil. And there's no wrong place that you can put these. I like to have my base coats on so I can kind of work around that the pieces that are in the design instead of just filling the whole thing in and then coming and putting it on. I think this makes a more cohesive look for the background. Let's add some smaller ones in here, and then we can come back and add more big ones if we need them. A little bit more of that mix. I'm trying to go to a dry spot on my paper towel. I could probably just bring a dry paper towel over here. That would probably be a little bit more helpful. And you want your circles to overlap each other to be a little bit of everywhere. I'm not going to worry if I get into my bird right there because, you know, it's going to be red eventually. So I'm going to get just a tiny bit more white and just go all around. Put as many or as little as you want. I like kind of a lot. I really like them to be overlapping. And I like them to be varying in color. Pick up a little bit more of that raw sienna so I can create some little little bit more of the rusty colored ones. And bouquet is the word bouquet just means blurred out background. So I mean, that's all it is. It's usually something that is referred to in photography. But you can use that effect in anything. Okay. So just play around with your values and let's make some going off the edge over here. And I think I might put a couple more big ones in here. Right over the bird's leg, so I'll have to put that line back in. No problem. So the background goes really fast when you use a stencil, and you can get those circles in there. I think that looks pretty good for our background. I think I'm happy with that. So we're done with the stencils. And I didn't even have to use my small stencil brush. I did all of it with that medium size one. So that worked out great. So let's put a base coat on our bird here. We're going to base the bird in with some tomato red. Now we're not going to do the beak. Let me draw it in with the pencil. You might be able to see it a little bit better. The beak will stay gray. So let's see. It comes down here. And I might need to make the beak a little bit longer, so I might have to put a little bit more gray in there. So the rest of the bird will paint with the red. Let me make the beak a little bit longer out here. So we're going to paint in with this red. And we're not going to worry about where the feathers and all that, you know, the wing and the tail feathers go. We'll create that as we go. This is actually our base coat. The gray was the undercoat so that we could put our base coat on. So you want to have nice smooth coats. I like to add a tiny little bit of water to my paint with my base coats because it just makes smoother. You don't have super thick paint. I mean, especially if your paint is thick, you want to add a little bit of water to thin it down. So how many of you like the bouquet effect in the background, or do you prefer the snow? I am a big fan of the bouquet effect, but so that's our first coat on there. So we're going to let that dry. I want to go up here to the topper. So with the topper, because the topper is not going to take any time at all to paint in, we're going to connect this side to this side with a little bit of a curved line. And then this is a circle, so we want to make it look like it's a circle and bring those sides in. Okay, We're going to paint the negative space in here with some black. Just fill those spaces in. Try and make your circle look like a circle. Mine is not quite looking like a circle at the moment. There we go. A little bit better. Maybe it's an oblong circle. Okay, I'm going to put a little bit of gray right here because I got some of my bokeh effect in there. Okay, so this is where you're going to want an angle or a flat brush to do some shading, whichever you like to use for adding your floats with. Some people like to use a flat brush, some people like to use an angle brush. I like both. So I'm going to grab a 3/8 inch angle brush and wake it up with some water. And we're going to take a little bit of this black on our brush and just work a little bit in there, a nice soft color, because I've got some water in my brush, so it's keeping that paint from being very opaque. And black can take over so quickly. So we're going to shade on the outside edges here, just a nice soft little shading of color. I'm going to flip it around and do the other edge. And you can walk it in just a little bit. We're going to put some, let's see, where else did I put? I put a little bit here. Not too much because our highlight goes through the center, but we got a little bit of a shadow there. This edge and on this edge. Okay. I did not come, it doesn't look like, across the bottom. Nope, I just did the outer edges. Okay, we need to let that dry and repeat it. Bit more. Not too much down here. We're going to highlight along there. It's already looking like a rounded piece of metal, isn't it? Just with that little bit of shading. All right, we're going to take some white. Now I'm going to show you how to do a back-to-back float. Floats are very easy. We're still going to, we have water in our brush, we're loading it with some white and working it in to get a nice soft color. We don't want harsh stuff here, so we're going to go down the center, and this is really going to fade in there because I have water in my brush, and there is quite the glare. Let me move that light off of it. You can see it a little bit better. I'm going to flip my brush around and go right next to that. Walk it over a little bit. I'm going to do this on the round thing as well. Go right back to that spot where I was loading, and we do want some through here. That's why I didn't want that shadow right there to be very high up. Okay, so that is the first float, and that is very glaring. So you can see it a little bit better on this one. So I'm going to repeat that, and it will brighten it. Work that white just into the toe of my brush. float down the center. Flip my brush over, float down the center on this side, up here. Flip my brush. Starting to run out of paint now, so I need a little bit here. Okay, JoAnn, you didn't see it with the snow. Okay, let me show that one real quick. So that's pretty much it for the topper. Topper's pretty much done. This is the one with the snow. So if you like the winter background, you'll do the snow stuff at the end. You know, make your little piles of snow wherever you want, and then spatter some thin white everywhere. And then I take the up brush and remove big spots off my bird. It does have some snow on it, but I removed any really big spots off of there. So that's the snow one. Okay, so that's the topper. That's done. Super fast, isn't it? Crazy super fast. So I can see that here I used black and it's a little bit darker. Here I probably used like a dark gray value where I mixed my black and my white. I kind of like that a little bit better. So let me just make a dark gray with my black and white, and I'll paint that in with this color. This is just the negative space. We don't really need to see it, and I think that dark gray kind of pushes it out of the out of your eyesight. It takes it away, so all you really notice is the topper itself. And that looks better. I like that a little bit better. All right, let's put a second coat on our bird here. And you see that I added some water to my paint to get it nice and thin, because when you're applying your second coat, it can be even thinner than your first coat, because all you're doing is filling in the gaps where the paint didn't cover well the first time. Like, see all these areas here where I can still see a little bit of gray. So this is just filling in those gaps. So you don't really need a full heavy layer of paint with your second coat generally, unless you've got just a really dark background that is so hard to cover up. There is that second coat, so we're ready to start adding some detail onto our bird. Let me dry him real quick. Put my light back over here. Okay, so with the beak, zoom you in. We've got a line, which you won't be able to see that white. We got a line that goes down the center, which we'll have to paint that line next to that line. So these are the brushes that I'm going to use, and they're pretty small brushes. These are chisel blender brushes. I love these brushes in all sizes. They are my favorite. They are shorter than your standard flat brush. The bristles are shorter, and they work beautifully for floating. So I'm going to use one of these to float on this beak, and the beak is pretty small. So when you're using these smaller brushes, they do not hold a lot of paint. So you are generally loading more frequently. So I woke my brush up in the water and just wicked out the excess on my paper towel. So now, and with these small brushes, you got to make sure that you don't let the paint get all the way across the bristles. That's the tough part of it. You just want a tiny little bit of paint on one corner of your brush. So we'll float at the back. Oh, get you on camera. At the back here. Okay. You have to do it in stages because it has to dry. Or you'll just remove what you just put on. So I'll dry that real quick. And we're going to go underneath this line. And then remembering which side the paint is on is the other thing. So we're going to go under that line. You want to try not to fill in your entire beak. But keep a damp brush handy in case you get a little bit more on there than you want. You can remove it real quickly. We're going to repeat that because it's got to be much darker, but I want to add in the black around the face. And so it's going to come out like this and come around and come down like this. And it's going to be all just strokes coming out from the beak of just black. Add a little bit of water. So it will come off of the tip of your brush nicely. And you want to start up here and just make some little strokes. And we're going to come out. And of course, you know, we'll have to repeat this a couple of times to get it nice and opaque. More water in my paint. It should flow off of the tip of your brush very easily. And don't worry too much about if you get too big or anything like that, because when we come in with our red paint, we can take it down and adjust the size of it. So this is just getting that, you know, laid in there where you need to have it. All right, I'm going to go back to the beak. And this needs to be quite a bit darker. I think I may have to darken the entire beak. It needs to be a little bit darker. So with your beak, you could fill it in with a little bit of dark gray. So I'm going to mix a little bit of gray sky and black. Get a darker gray. I want to have some place to go for my highlight when I put it on. Right now my highlight's already on there, so I'm just going to fill this in with a dark gray value. And then I'll come back in and float my shading. Okay, so the wing is going to be somewhere in here and come down somewhere around in there. Let's see, his leg here, and then his claws wrap around this wire, and we can paint those in with some gray sky or some dark gray, either one. Let's make a dark value gray here. And we'll paint our legs in. I'm not going to put the claws on yet because I need to put that wire on, and I don't want to put the wire on until I get the post done. Okay, I'm going to put some Tuscan Red out. Let's start adding a few strokes on the bird to give the illusion of feathers. I'm going to start with, I think I'm going to use, where is it? There it is. My angle brush here, my 3/8 inch angle. So I'm going to vary my red values on my bird a little bit just by mixing these colors right here. My tomato red, my lamp black, and my Tuscan red, and I can get varying values for my bird. So I'm going to start with the tomato red and a tiny little bit of black. Now remember, black is a strong color, and it will take over your color very, very quickly. Okay, so I'm going to use this bigger brush down here. I just want to start creating the look of some feather type stuff on here. And I'm doing kind of long strokes, but we'll vary our strokes as we build our layers on this bird. Mix a little more here, a little bit of water. We'll make it flow off of my brush very nicely. And our tail feathers down here, we'll put some. And I'm going to go to my round brush for the head and start pulling some out here. Ooh, a lot of black. A little bit more red in there. Need water because it's not flowing. Now you can use a detail liner here. I'm using a one round. Going to kind of come around this way, and then these will all start falling down this direction. So shape following is important when you're doing any kind of animal. I'm going to put a little bit on the chest, but overall the chest we don't have to worry too much about the feathery look because I made it look a little bit more smooth on the chest. So we've got some good color going on there. I'm going to go back up to the beak and see if I can finish that shading out on it with some black. Our tiny little brush here. A little bit more paint. I'm going to try and get the moisture out of my brush so this covers a little bit better. Okay, that looks much better. All right, let's put another layer on the bird here. We're going to take some of our Tuscan red and some black. This is a much brighter red here. And so this will start, ooh, that's a lot of paint. This will start brightening up our bird a little bit. We need different values in here to make it look. Oh, you'd probably like to see the whole bird, wouldn't you? One of those times when I wish it had sound on your end so you could. Need a little bit more black down here. I had to wide out a little bit so you can see more of the bird. Okay, I'm going to put a little bit of this up here and down next to the wing. And then grab my round brush and put that same color mix, which is our Tuscan red and some black up here. And then come around this way. Anywhere that you feel needs it. I'm going to pull some of this red into, I'm going to mix a little bit of both reds, a little bit too much on my brush, and pull some into the black. We're going to redo our black here in a minute, but we need our red and our black to blend together a little bit more. When we're done, we can add more red or black, whichever way we see that it needs it. So now we're going to take the black and put another layer on here. Right up to that beak. This is all really dark in here. So I titled this piece Visiting Friend because I had heard that when you see a cardinal, it's some friend or family member that is visiting. And my dad loved cardinals, so I always like to think that it's my dad visiting me. All right, I'm going to put a little bit of red back in here. Just pull some thin little strokes in there. And you can't see that red, so I'm going to go into the tomato red because it's a little bit more opaque. That Tuscan red is more transparent. So I'll do it with this one so you can see a little bit. We want a blend of the two. I'm going to take this brush and get a little bit more black in my mix. And I want to pull a little bit of darker stuff out here. Okay, let's do another layer on the wings. I'm just going to use the Tuscan red this time. And this will really brighten him up. A little bit down here. Are you ready for an eye? Okay, so the eye is super, super easy, okay? I know you're probably thinking, oh my gosh, I can't do that eye, but it's super, super easy. So I'm gonna take my gray sky and add a tiny bit of black to it to darken it up just a little bit. And I'm gonna paint a C stroke in here. Okay, now I'm going to take that same paint, put a little dot for a highlight. Now, wasn't that the easiest eye you've ever painted? And if it gets too fat, which I feel like my C got just a little bit fat, you just take your black and go beside your C and thin it down just a little bit. Oop. Don't take it completely away like I just did. Just thin it down just a little bit. And just make a black C right next to it and leave just a little bit of that gray showing. Just tiny little scooch. Right, I'm going to erase this line here. Let's start shading on our bird. So we're going to take some of our black and our Tuscan red, maybe tomato red, something that can be a little bit more. Just mix this dark red burgundy-like color. And we're going to go next to the wing. I need a little tiny bit more black in there. Right there, just darken that just a little bit. We need to paint a leg on him. I completely forgot about his, he has a part of his leg is showing here. That, the bone comes out from, the bony part. So we need to put that in. We have to shade on that. So don't leave that part off. Let's go underneath the tail here. I'm going to do a smooth line across here and then pull a little bit of that. Streak it. Give it a little bit more. I almost filled that completely in, so I'm going to take some of my tomato red and put it back on top of it. I want to see the look of tail feathers, but we don't really want it to be completely filled in. All right, mixing a little bit more red in there so it's not quite as black. And it looks like on the piece that I have painted here, like I put some more, a little bit more black. Like I put some darker strokes right through here and right through here. Just darken up a little bit. Not that one. Don't like that one. And just darken it a little bit. Get another coat of red on that leg. We're almost done with our what we can do to the bird because we can't finish the feet till we do the wire. Let me dry that leg. We'll put a little float of that mix on it. I've got my smaller flat here, or flat, my smaller angle. I gotta make sure I just load the very tippy toe of this one. So we can go right there. Now, highlighting on the bird, you don't really need a whole lot to highlight. I'm gonna actually use this fiery red. You can use an orange, like a bright, transparent orange to highlight with. This color is really going to pop. I can mix it with my Tuscan red if I feel like it's going to be too bright. So I'm going to put just a little bit on the chest and on the edge of the wing. This is very transparent. Neon color, and I like to put it along the edge of the wing to brighten that up. I'm going to put a little bit on the tail, just pull a few little streaks in there, and then right here I'm going to pull a little bit, just the very tip of that brush, bring in some highlight in there, and a couple down the back. Ooh, that's way too much paint on my brush right there. And a couple on the top of the head, which I think I better go to my round brush for that, or I'm going to make a big mess. So that's going to give our bird its brightness. If you feel like any of your shading needs to be darkened, you can do that. And let me put just a little highlight on the front of that leg. Okay, so that is the Cardinal. He is so cute. I love him. Oh, he needs a little highlight on his beak. Just a tiny little one of some white. Just give a little tap along the front of the beak right there. So easy. Okay, Cardinal is done. We're going to work on the post. All right, let's see what colors I used on the post. Let's see, we're going to use soft black and burnt umber and, of course, lamp black and raw sienna. We've got raw sienna. I'm going to put more lamp black out, and we'll put some soft black out and some burnt umber. And your post can look any way that you want it to. I kind of made mine where the water had just worn out the top of it and almost made like a well in it. I did that on both of these, but on this one I just kept it straight. So it's really whatever appeals to you. I'll probably keep it more straight on this one. All right, I'm going to go to my large flat brush because we're going to be covering a large area here. I'm going to start with burnt umber. And I'm side loading. just on one edge. And we're going to go down the side of the post with this color. Doesn't have to be smooth, can be choppy. It's a wood post. We want it to look pretty beat up. Like it's been, this fence post has been around for a long time. Long time. Go all the way to your edge though. We don't want to see any of that light color coming through. And I'm just going to streak some of this through our post since I have it on my brush. A little bit of water. So I'm going to leave the top of my post on this one flat. So I'm going to take some of this and just pull down from that edge and start creating some wood grain look in our post. Okay, I'm not going to clean my brush. I'm going to go into some soft black, a little bit of water. Work that in. And I'm going to just put some of this in here randomly. I'm almost dry brushing, just letting the brush hit the surface where it wants to and leave whatever paint it wants to leave. That's what it's leaving. Pretty easy, huh? Let's make a few little knots or something in there. And we'll use some burnt umber and just start creating some knots and lines in here. Wherever you want them, however many you want. This is just burnt umber. And we can create some very thin lines in here by thinning down some of the burnt umber and start creating even more texture and age and everything like that. And we're just using burnt umber. We're going to go into some soft black here. Ooh, that's a lot of paint right there. Lots of paint! Not that it matters too much with that because, you know, this is wood. I'm going to put another knot thing down here. Maybe one down here at the bottom. And you can make some extra lines going around your knot. You know, just be a little creative. Don't be too, be a little bit more loose when you're creating a wood post. It's a looser thing. All right, some soft black. Okay, we want this knot to be a little bit deeper in here, so I'm going to put a little soft black in the center of it. And then we're going to do the same thing with the soft black and create some little streaks in here. Thin your paint down with some water so it's inky consistency, so it flows off of your brush very easily. That's too many in a row right there. We don't want our lines lined up like soldiers here. We want to be very loose and flowy and creative. And I mean, we've all seen wood that looks like it's lived its life. Weathered and worn. Okay, it's looking pretty good. All right, we're gonna add some lighter stuff in here with our white and raw sienna. And create a few little highlights in here as well. Thin that a little bit more. There we go. And I get some flow here. We can put a little bit of a highlight of this on each side or whichever side of the knot that you want to be a little more pronounced. So that's going to make that knot look even deeper. Put a few of these up here at the top, kind of drag them down a little bit more with the flat of the brush. Start creating a little bit of a highlight edge up there. You can do as little or as much of this on here as you want. I'm going to erase this line over here. All right, let's deepen our shading with our soft black. Ooh, too much water. Way too much water. I need water, just didn't need that much water. And I really want this to come over a little bit farther, so I guess I will pick up a little bit more water. And bring it over, make this post more dirty now. Bring what's left in your brush kind of through the post. And that's really going to start making it look a lot more aged. I want to get it dry because I want to put some black in here for a little bit darker shadow and then some bright highlights. Some black. I'm actually going to mix my soft black with a little black so it doesn't, it's not pure black. The soft black has more of a brown tint to it, and I like that about it. It's not quite as opaque as what black is, though. So I'm going to bring some black down and over a little bit on the bottom. Looking pretty darn good for a post. We need a little bit of highlight on the top here with some white, and we can streak a little bit of white down the post as well. So I'm just going to use my angle brush so I can kind of skim the edge up here and give it a little bit of a highlight and then pull some down. This is really weathered up here. You could add some of the gray values in here as well to give it more of a gray weathered wood. If you prefer the gray, you can use all grays and blacks on this. Just different values of gray and black and white. If you want a more that look of a post. Okay, let me get this dry. We're ready to do our wire. My wire comes across here and across here, and then it wraps around, kind of comes down and wraps back around, and this will wrap around as well. So this one is wrapping around, and then another one is wrapping around and coming below. Okay, then we have these I call them backward S's. So there'll be like a circle here. It goes this way and this way. And you can put these anywhere on your wire that you would like to. I'm just going to put a couple, you know, draw them on here so you can kind of see what we're going for here. Let's do one here. And I think that'll be good. You know, you can have one kind of peeking out from around here if you want. Just use your imagination with that. So we're going to put it in with, I'm going to make a medium gray value here. So I'm using my gray sky and my black, but if you're mixing just white and black, just make a medium value. And we'll put our wire in. And I'm going to add a little bit of water because I'm getting my wire a little thick. So that comes around there and comes around there. Let me take that off of the front of the post because that's going behind it, and then this one comes around and it's down here. And continues on over here. All right, and we'll mix a little bit more here. Water to thin it. And then we'll do this one. Goes across here. And I don't know, on a regular fence, the wire's probably not this close, but. And then this one comes and drops down. And I need more water and more paint. Okay, then your little things here, just create a little circle almost, and some little tails. Okay. I'm going to do his feet, but I'm going to grab a smaller. We'll see if this brush will do it. I'm going to have to go back to that one I was just using. And we'll put his feet coming in. I'm going to zoom you in for this part. Okay, so his feet are wrapped around this wire. So we've got one that comes up like that. Beside it, and then this one in the front wraps around this direction. So our wire is in front of that one, but it's behind these two. So same thing here, and you need nice thin strokes here. Don't let them get too fat. Let me make that one a little bit darker so you can see it over that. Okay. All right. We're going to be using a round brush to kind of finish out the wire, and then we'll shade underneath the wire. I'm going to work on his feet first, and we're going to grab a little bit of black. And this is where you want a brush that can be a nice thin stroke here. I'm going to grab some water and mix in with that black. So a detail liner is definitely going to be your friend here. And go along the back edge of the legs. Okay. Put a little bit coming down on these claws here. Okay, so that claw is behind, so You need a little bit right there and right there. And we'll kind of separate those two. And then we're going to do this black beside the claws and beside the bird. And we can go a little bit along the bottom of the wire for a shadow. We're going to make a shadow on the wire itself. And when we get to this wire where it overlaps, we definitely want a little dark here where it goes behind. Kind of separate your wires there. A little dark in here. Along one edge on each of your tails. My wire got really thin over here. Thin wire. Some more water to my paint. A little bit in here. This is creating the shadows. Okay, which one's on top? Put that one on top. And then go along the bottom of this one. Okay, go over here and do this side. We are almost done with this project. Go down here and do this wire real quick. When we put the shadow underneath our wire, that little black line that we put on there won't show up quite so much. Okay, let's take our white and we'll highlight everything. Ooh, that's a lot of paint, don't need that much. A little bit along the front of the claws, and we want to make sure we know that these are claws, except for that one doesn't go across. No line there. Front of this leg, and then on the top of the wire, just kind of dry brush it along there. Don't make it solid, just a little hit and miss kind of highlight is all this is. Across there, across this way. All right, a little bit out here. Oh, probably like to be on camera. And white is notorious for fading into a project. So some of these highlights you will want to go back and brighten up a little bit. Just pick a few places that you really want to make that highlight pop. I definitely want it a little bit brighter on the legs. And then just a couple places along your wire. Okay. So now we just need to shade underneath the wire. And I'll use my smaller angle for that with some black. Try and get a little bit of that moisture out of my brush. And we'll go underneath here. A little bit too much paint. Just underneath the wire that's on the fence is the only place we're going. And you can repeat this if you want some darker shadows in here. Maybe your wire's sticking out a little bit farther in a couple places than other places. There we go. There is our cardinal. He's all done. He is so pretty and so red. And I love him. That is it. Oh my gosh, you guys. Thank you so much for hanging in there with me and for being here with me. My first live in 2 years. And it happened. So I will definitely be doing more of these, be counting on that now that I have one under my belt and I feel a little bit better about it. So if you've got any comments or questions, leave them in there. I definitely will get back to you on any of those. And thank you guys so incredibly much for staying with me and painting with me. I just appreciate you all so much. Let's see if I can bring myself up now. I'm not really sure where I'm at. Nope, that's not it. Ah, there I am. Okay, there we go. We got it done. Oh my gosh, alive under my belt. So I will be doing so much more of this. Thank you, Rosanna. I am so glad that you enjoyed it. And I will be doing so many more. If you have any ideas of anything that you would like for me to be doing on a live, just let me know, because this is the way I want to go for the future, is doing lives here on YouTube. So I look forward to seeing you guys on the next one. Thank you so much for sticking with me and painting with me if you painted. And if not, and you're going to paint it later, I definitely want to see some pictures. So head over to Facebook and share your pictures. You can find me there at facebook.com/LonnaLambDesigns. And or just find me on Facebook and post your pictures and tag me in them and I will see them. So thank you guys so much. I'll see you on the next one, everybody. Bye-bye.